10 18th century political formation. If you look at map 1 and 2 closely, you will see something significant happening in the subcontinent during the first half of the 18th century. Notice how the boundaries of the Mughal Empire were reshaped by the emergence of a number of independent. Map 1, state formation in the 18th century. Lahore, Sikhs, Panipat, Delhi, Jats, Bharatpur, Agra, Gwalior, Jaipur, Jodhpur, Awadh, Lucknow, Gujarat, Malwa, Bhopal, Baroda, Murshidabad, Bengal, Marathas, Pune, Hyderabad, Arabian Sea, Bengal, Indian Ocean. External boundary of Mughal Empire 1700. Kingdoms. By 1765, notice how another power, the British, had successfully grabbed major chunks of territory in eastern India. What these maps tell us is that political conditions in 18th century India changed quite dramatically and within a relatively short span of time. In this chapter, we will read about the emergence of new political groups in the subcontinent during the first half of the 18th century, roughly from 1707. When Aurangzeb died, till the third battle of Panipat in 1761. Indus River, Satluj River, Sikhs, Lahore, Sindh, Gujarat, Baroda, Narmada River, Rajput, Delhi, Agra, Jamuna River, Ganga River, Rohilkhand, Lucknow, Awadh, Allahabad, Benaras, Patna, Bihar, Murshidabad, Bengal, Calcutta, Dhaka, Odisha, Northern Sarkars. Surat, Marathas, Pune, Godavari River, Nizam, Hyderabad, Krishna River, Hyderabad, Mysore, Arcot, Mysore, Karnatic, Kaveri River, Travancore, Diu, Damun and Diu, Bombay, British, Goa, Portuguese, Puducherry, French, Port St. David, British, Madras, Masulipatnam, Rajahmundry, Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal, Indian Ocean. Territory under British control, mid-18th century. The crisis of the empire and the later Mughals. In chapter 4, you saw how the Mughal Empire reached the height of its success and started facing a variety of crises towards the closing years of the 17th century. These were caused by a number of factors. Emperor Aurangzeb had depleted the military and financial resources of his empire by fighting a long war in the Deccan. Map 2. British territories in the mid-18th century. See chapter 4, table 1, which group of people challenged Mughal authority for the longest time in Aurangzeb's reign. Comment this. Under his successors, the efficiency of the imperial administration broke down. It became increasingly difficult for the later Mughal emperors to keep a check on their powerful mansabdars. Nobles appointed as governors, subadars, often controlled the offices of revenue and military administration, Diwani and Fauzdari as well. This gave them extraordinary political, economic and military powers over vast regions of the Mughal Empire. As the governors consolidated their control over the provinces, the periodic remission of revenue to the capital declined. Peasant and Jamindari rebellion in many parts of northern and western India added to these problems. These revolts were sometimes caused by the pressure of mounting taxes. At other times, they were attempts by powerful chieftains to consolidate their own position. Mughal authority had been challenged by rebellious groups in the past as well. But these groups were now able to seize the economic resources of the region to consolidate their position. The Mughal emperors after Aurangzeb were unable to arrest the gradual shifting of political and economic authority into the hands of provincial governors, local chieftains, and other groups. Rich harvest and empty coffers. The following is an contemporary writer's account of the financial bankruptcy of the empire. The great lords are helpless and impoverished. Their peasants raise 2 crops a year, but their lords see nothing of either, and their agents on the spot are virtual prisoners in the peasant's hands. Like a peasant kept in his creditor's house until he can pay his debt, so complete is the collapse of all order and administration that though the peasant reaps a harvest of gold, his lord does not see so much as a whiff of straw. How then can the lord keep the armed force he should? How can he pay the soldiers who should go before him when he goes out, or the horsemen who should ride behind him? Comment this. In the midst of this economic and political crisis, the ruler of Iran, Nadir Shah, sacked and plundered the city of Delhi in 1739 and took away immense amounts of wealth. The invasion was followed by a series of plundering raids by the Afghan ruler, Ahmed Shah Abdali, who invaded North India 5 times between 1748 and 1761. Nadir Shah attacks Delhi. The devastation of Delhi after Nadir Shah's invasion was described by contemporary observers. One described the wealth looted from the Mughal treasury as follows: 60 lakhs of rupees and some thousands gold coins, nearly 1 crore worth of gold ware, nearly 50 crore worth of jewels, most of them unrivaled in the world. And the above included the peacock throne. Another account described the invasion's impact upon Delhi. Those who had been masters were now in dire straits, and those who had been revered could not even get water to quench their thirst. The recluses were pulled out of their corners. The wealthy were turned into beggars. Those who once said the style in clothes now went naked, and those who owned property were now homeless. The new city, Shahjanabad, was turned into rubble. Nadir Shah then attacked the old quarters of the city and destroyed a whole world that existed there. Figure, a 1779 portrait of Nadir Shah. Already under severe pressure from all sides, the empire was further weakened by competition amongst different groups of nobles. They were divided into 2 major groups or factions, the Iranians and Turanis. The Iranis and Turanis, nobles of Turkish descent for a long time, the latter Mughals' emperors were puppets in the hands of either one or the other of these 2 powerful groups. The worst possible humiliation came when to Mughal emperors Farrukh Sher 1713-1719 and Alamgir II 1715-1759 were assassinated and two others, Ahmad Shah 1748 to 1754 and Shah Alam II 1759 to 1816, were blinded by their nobles. Emergence of new states. Farrukh Siyar receiving a novel in court. With the decline in authority of the Mughal emperors, the governors of large provinces, Subadars and the great Jamindars consolidated their authority in different parts of the subcontinent. Through the 18th century, the Mughal Empire gradually fragmented into a number of independent regional states. Broadly speaking, the states of the 18th century can be divided into three overlapping groups. 1. States that were old Mughal provinces like Awadh, Bengal, and Hyderabad, although extremely powerful and quite independent. The rulers of these states did not break their formal ties with the Mughal emperors. 2. States that had enjoyed considerable independence under the Mughals as Watan Jagirs. This included several Rajput principalities. 3. The last group included states under the control of Marathas, Sikhs, and other like the Jats. These were of differing sizes and had seized their independence from the Mughals after a long drawn armed struggle. The old Mughal provinces. Amongst the states that were carved out of the old Mughal provinces in the 18th century, three stand out very prominently. These were Awadh, Bengal, and Hyderabad. All three states were founded by members of high Mughal nobility who had been governors of large provinces. Sadat Khan, Awadh, Murshid Quli Khan, Bengal, and Asaf Jah, Hyderabad. All three had occupied high mansabdari positions and enjoyed the trust and confidence of the emperors. Both Asaf Jah and Murshid Quli Khan held a jet rank of 7,000 each, while Sadat Khan's jet was 6,000. Hyderabad. Nizamul Mulk Asaf Jah, the founder of Hyderabad state 1724 to 1748, was one of the most powerful members at the court of the Mughal Emperor Farrukh Siyar. He was entrusted first with the governorship of Awadh and later given charge of the Deccan. As the Mughal governor of the Deccan provinces during 1722-22, Asaf Jah had already gained control over its political and financial administration. Taking subsequent advantage of the turmoil in the Deccan and the competition amongst the court nobility, he gathered power in his hands and became the actual ruler of that region. Asaf Jah broad-scaled soldiers and administrators from northern India who welcomed the new opportunities in the south. He appointed mansabdars and granted jagirs. Although he was still a servant of the Mughal emperor, he ruled quite independently without seeking any direction from Delhi or facing any interference. The Mughal emperor merely confirmed the decisions already taken by the Nizamul Mulk Asaf Jah. The state of Hyderabad was constantly engaged in a struggle against the Marathas to the west and with independent Telugu warriors, chiefs, Nayakas of the plateau. The ambitions of the Nizamul Mulk Asaf Jah to control the rich textile producing areas of the Coromandel coast in the east were checked by the British, who were becoming increasingly powerful in that region. See map 2. The Nizam's army. A description of the Nizam of Hyderabad's personal troopers in 1790. The Nizam has a sari Sauri of 400 elephants, several thousand of horsemen near his person who receive upwards 100 rupees nominal pay and are extremely well mounted and richly caparisoned. Awad Burhanul Mulk Sadat Khan was appointed Subadar of Awad in 1722 and founded a state which was one of the most important to emerge out of the breakup of the Mughal Empire. Awad was a prosperous region, controlling the rich alluvial Ganga plain and the main trade route between North India and Bengal. Burhan-ul-Mulk also held the combined offices of Subadari, Diwani and Fauzdari. In other words, he was responsible for managing the political, financial and military affairs of the province of Awad. Figure Burhan-ul-Mulk, Sadat Khan. In trying to consolidate their rule, why did Mughal Subadars also want to control the office of Diwan? Comment this. Burhan-ul-Mulk tried to decrease Mughal influence in the Awad region by reducing the number of office holders, Jagirdars. Appointed by the Mughals, he also reduced the size of Jagirs and appointed his own loyal servants to vacant position. The accounts of Jagirdars were checked to prevent cheating and the revenue of all districts were reassessed by official appointed by the Nawab's court. He seized a number of Rajput, Jamindaris and the agriculturally fertile lands of the Afghans of Rohilkhand. The state dependent on local bankers and Mahajanas for loans, it sold the right to collect tax to the highest bidders. This revenue farmers, Ijaradars, agreed to pay the state a fixed sum of money. Local bankers guaranteed the payment of this contracted amount to the state. In turn, the revenue farmers were given considerable freedom in the assessment and collection of taxes. These developments allowed new social groups like money lenders and bankers to influence the management of the state's revenue system, something which had not occurred in the past. Bengal gradually broke away from Mughal control under Murshid Quli Khan, who was appointed as the Naib Deputy to the governor of the province, although never a formal Subadar. Murshid Quli Khan very quickly seized all the power that went with that office. Like the rulers of Hyderabad and Awadh, he also commanded the revenue administration of the state. In an effort to reduce Mughal influence in Bengal, he transferred all Mughal Jagirdars to Odisha and ordered a major reassessment of the revenues of Bengal. Revenue was collected in cash with great strictness from all Jamindars. As a result, many Jamindars had to borrow money from bankers and money lenders. Those unable to pay were forced to sell their lands to larger Jamindars. The formation of a regional state in 18th century Bengal therefore led to considerable change amongst the Jamindars, the close connection between the state and bankers. Noticeable in Figure Ali Burdi Khan holding court. Hyderabad and Awadh as well was evident in Bengal under the rule of Ali Burdi Khan. Rule 1740 to 1756. During his reign, the banking house of Jagat Seth became extremely prosperous. If we take a bird's eye view, we can detect three common features among these states. First, though many of the larger states were established by erstwhile Mughal nobles, they were highly suspicious of some of the administrative system that they had inherited, in particular the Jagirdari system. Second, their method of tax collection differed. Rather than relying upon the officers of the state, all three regimes contracted with revenue farmers for the collection of revenue. The practice of Ijaradari, thoroughly disapproved of by the Mughals, spread all over India in the 18th century. Their impact on the countryside differed considerably. The third common feature in all these regional states was their emerging relationship with rich bankers and merchants. These peoples lent money to revenue farmers, received land as security, and collected taxes from these lands through their own agents. Throughout India, the richest merchants and bankers were gaining a stake in the new political order. The Watan Jagirs of the Rajputs. Many Rajput kings, particularly those belonging to Amber and Jodhpur, had served under the Mughals with distinction. In exchange, they were permitted to enjoy considerable autonomy in their Watan Jagirs. In the 18th century, these rulers now attempted to extend their control over adjacent regions. Ajit Singh, the ruler of Jodhpur, was also involved in the factional politics at the Mughal court. These influential Rajput families claimed the Subadari of the rich provinces of Gujarat and Malwa. Raja Ajit Singh of Jodhpur held the governorship of Gujarat, and Shawai Raja Jai Singh of Amber was governor of Malwa. These offices were renewed by Emperor Jahandar Shah in 1713. Many Rajput rulers had accepted the sovereignty of the Mughals, but Mewar was the only Rajput state which defied Mughal authority. Rana Pratap ascended the throne at Mewar in 1572 with Udaipur and large part of Mewar under his control. A series of envoys were sent to the Rana to persuade him to accept Mughal sovereignty, but he stood his ground. They also tried to extend their territories by seizing portion of imperial territories neighboring their Watans. Nagaur was conquered and annexed to the House of Jodhpur, while Amber seized large portion of Bundi. Sawai Raja Jai Singh founded his new capital at Jaipur and was given the Subadari of Agra in 1722. Maratha campaigns into Rajasthan from the 1740s put severe pressure on these principalities and checked their further expansions. Figure: Chittorgarh Fort, Rajasthan. Many Rajput chieftains built a number of forts on hilltops which became centers of power. With extensive fortification, this majestic structure housed urban centers, places, temples, trading centers, water harvesting structures, and other buildings. The Chittorgarh fort contained many water bodies varying from talabs, ponds, to kundis, wells, bowlies, step wells, etc. Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur. A description of Raja Jai Singh in a Persian account of 1732. Raja Jai Singh was at the height of his power. He was the governor of Agra for 12 years and of Malwa for 5 or 6 years. He possessed a large army, artillery, and great wealth. His sway extended from Delhi to the banks of the Narmada. Figure: Jantar Mantar in Jaipur. Sawai Jai Singh, the ruler of Amber, constructed 5 astronomical observatories, one each in Delhi, Jaipur, Ujjain, Mathura, and Varanasi. Commonly known as Jantar Mantar, these observatories had various instruments to study heavenly bodies. Figure: Mehrgarh Fort, Jodhpur. Sieging independence. The Sikhs. The organization of the Sikhs into a political community during the 17th century, see chapter 8, helped in regional state building in the Punjab. Several battles were fought by Guru Gobind Singh against the Rajput and Mughal rulers. Both before and after the institutions of the Khalsa in 1699, after his death in 1708, the Khalsa rose in revolt against the Mughal authority under Banda Bahadur's leadership, declared their sovereign rule by striking coins in the name of Guru Nanak and Guru Gobind Singh, and established their own administration between the Sutlej and the Jamuna. Banda Bahadur was captured in 1715 and executed in 1716. What is the Khalsa? Do you recall reading about it in chapter 8? Comment this. Figure showed up Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Under a number of able leaders in the 18th century, the Sikhs organized themselves into a number of bands called Jathas, and later on Misals. Their combined forces were known as the Grand Army, Dal Khalsa. The entire body used to meet at Amritsar at the time of Baishakhi and Diwali to take collective decisions known as resolutions of the Guru Gurmatas. A system called Rakhi was introduced, offering protection to cultivators on the payment of a tax of 20% of the produce. Figure. Portrait of Shivaji. Guru Gobind Singh had inspired the Khalsa with the belief that their destiny was to rule Raj Karega Khalsa. Their well-knit organization enabled them to put up a successful resistance to the Mughal governors first and then to Ahmad Shah Abdali, who had seized the rich province of the Punjab and the Sarkar of the Sirhind from the Mughals. The Khalsa declared their sovereign rule by striking their own coin again in 1765. Significantly, the coin bore the same inscription as the one on the orders issued by the Khalsa in the time of Banda Bahadur. The Sikh territories in the late 18th century extended from the Indus to the Jamuna, but they were divided under different rulers. One of them, Maharaja Ranjit Singh, reunited these groups and established his capital at Lahore in 1799. Towards the end of the 17th century, a powerful state started emerging in the Deccan under the leadership of Shivaji, which finally led to the establishment of the Maratha state. Shivaji was born to Shahaji and Jijabai at Sibneri in 1630. Under the guidance of his mother and his guardian Dada Kondev, Shivaji embarked on a career of conquest at a young age. The occupation of Jabli made him the undisputed leader of the Mawala Highlands, which paved the way for further expansion. His exploit against the forces of Bijapur and the Mughals made him a legendary figure. He often resorted to guerrilla warfare against his opponents. By introducing an efficient administrative system supported by a revenue collection method based on Chauth and Sardeshmukhi, he laid the foundation of a strong Maratha state. The Marathas. The Maratha kingdom was another powerful regional kingdom to arise out of a sustained opposition to Mughal rule. Shivaji, 1627-1680, carved out a stable kingdom with the support of powerful warriors, families, Deshmukhs, groups of highly mobile peasant pastoralist Kunbis provided the backbone of the Maratha army. Shivaji used these forces to challenge the Mughals in the peninsula. After Shivaji's death, effective power in the Maratha state was wielded by a family of Chitpavan Brahmanas who served Shivaji's successors as Peshwa for principal or principal minister. Pune became the capital of the Maratha kingdom. Under the Peshwas, the Marathas developed a very successful military organization. Their success lay in bypassing the fortified areas of the Mughals, by raiding cities and by engaging Mughal armies in areas where their supply lines and reinforcement could be easily disturbed. Between 1720 and 1761, the Maratha Empire expanded. It gradually chipped away at the authority of the Mughal Empire. Malwa and Gujarat were seized from the Mughals by the 1720s. By the 1730s, the Maratha king was recognized as the overlord of the entire Deccan Peninsula. He possessed the right to levy Chauth and Sardesmukhi in the entire region. Bajirao I, also known as Bajirao Ballal, was the son of Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath. He was a great Maratha general who is credited to have expanded the Maratha kingdom beyond the Bindhas and is known for his military campaigns against Malwa, Bundelkhand, Gujarat and the Portuguese. After raiding Delhi in 1737, the frontiers of Maratha domination expanded rapidly into Rajasthan and the Punjab in the north, into Bengal and Odisha in the east, and into Karnataka and the Tamil and Telugu countries in the south, see map 1. These were not formally included in the Maratha Empire but were made to pay tribute as a way of accepting Maratha sovereignty. Expansion brought enormous resources, but it came at a price. These military campaigns also made other rulers hostile towards the Marathas. As a result, they were not inclined to support the Marathas during the Third Battle of Panipat in 1761. Chauth, 25% of the land revenue claimed by Jamindars. In the Deccan, this was collected by the Marathas. Sardeshimukh, 9-10% of the land revenue paid to the head revenue collector in the Deccan. Alongside endless military campaigns, the Marathas developed an effective administrative system as well. Once conquest had been completed and Maratha rule was secured, revenue demands were gradually introduced, taking local condition into account. Agriculture was encouraged and trade revived. This allowed Maratha chief sardars like Sindhia of Gwalior, Gaikwad of Baroda and Bhosle of Nagpur the resources to raise powerful armies. Maratha campaigns into Malwa in the 1720s did not challenge the growth and prosperity of the cities in the region. Ujjain expanded under Sindhia's patronage and Indore under Holkar's. By all accounts, these cities were large and prosperous and functioned as important commercial and cultural centers. New trade routes emerged within the areas controlled by the Marathas. The silk produced in the Chanderi region now found a new outlet in Pune. The Maratha capital, Burhanpur, which had earlier participated in the trade between Agra and Surat, now expanded its hinterland to include Pune and Nagpur in the south and Lucknow and Allahabad in the east. The Jats. Like the other states, the Jats consolidated their power during the late 17th and 18th centuries under their leader, Chauraman. They accounted control over territories situated to the west of the city of Delhi, and by the 1680s they had begun dominating the region between the two imperial cities of Delhi and Agra. For a while they became the virtual custodians of the city of Agra. The power of the Jats reached its zenith under Suraj Mal, who consolidated who consolidated the Jat state at Bharatpur in present-day Rajasthan during 1756 to 1763. The areas under the political controls of Surajmal broadly included parts of modern eastern Rajasthan, southern Haryana, western Uttar Pradesh and Delhi. Surajmal built a number of forts and places, and the famous Lohagarh fort in Bharatpur is regarded as one of the strongest forts built in this region. The Jats were prosperous agriculturists, and towns like Panipat and Ballabgarh became important trading centers in the areas dominated by them. Under Surajmal, the kingdom of Bharatpur emerged as a strong state. When Nadir Shah sacked Delhi in 1739, many of the city's notables took refuge there. His son Jawahir Shah had 30,000 troops of his own and hired figure. 18th century palace complex at Dik, note the Bangla Dome, on the assembly hall on the roof of the building. Another 20,000 Maratha and 15,000 Sikh troops to fight the Mughals. While the Bharatpur fort was built in a fairly traditional style, at Dik the Jats built an elaborate garden place combining styles seen at Amber and Agra. Its buildings were modeled on architectural forms first associated with royalty under Shah Jahan. See figure 12 in chapter 5 and figure 12 in chapter 9. The French Revolution, 1789 to 1794. Elsewhere, in the various state systems of 18th century of India, the common people did not enjoy the right to participate in the affairs of their governments. In the Western world, this was the situation until the late 18th century. The American 1776 to 1781 and French Revolution challenged the social and political privilege enjoyed by the aristocrats. During the French Revolution, the middle classes, peasants and artisans fought against the special rights enjoyed by the clergy and the nobility. The belief that no group in society should have privilege based on birth, rather people's social position must depend on merit. The philosophers of the French Revolution suggested that there be equal laws and opportunities for all. They also held that the authority of the government should come from the people, who must possess the right to participate in its affairs. Movements such as the French and American Revolutions gradually transformed subjects into citizens. The ideas of citizenship, nation-state, and democratic rights took root in India from the late 19th century. Imagine you are a ruler of an 18th century kingdom. Tell us about the steps you would take to make your position strong in your province and what opposition or problems you might face while doing so. Comment this. Keywords: Subadari, Dal Khalsa, Misal, Pauzdari, Izaradari, Chauth, Sardesh Mukhi. Let's recall. Let's discuss. Let's do this and comment this.